to their opponent in the playoffs. We'll tell you who they play and our own look back at the career of the one and only Wizard. Plus, we'll take you to the desert where the Rams took on the Cardinals, but they may face the real heat when they get back. It's Sports Plus, and it's coming your way next. Good evening, everybody. I'm Mike Bush, and this is Sports Plus. It's been a weekend of farewells. And some are already putting this season behind them. Others just want to know who they'll play next. Now, while some said goodbye, others said hello. The Rams opened their bank, and they may have found an answer. And others, well, they're still looking. Will this battle ever get back on the field? Take your seat and find out. This show won't be over until... Oh, never mind. No, you don't have to wait that long. Sports Plus begins now. And thanks for keeping me company. We're glad you're with us for another Sports Plus Sunday. It's a special edition tonight. You know, St. Louis has spent the last 4 days saying goodbye to Ozzie Smith. A little later on, we'll pay our own tribute to the Wizard of Oz, looking back on a Hall of Fame career with family members, teammates, and, of course, Ozzie himself. Plus, it was the game St. Louis football fans have been waiting for 8 years, a chance to get some revenge. We'll take you live to Arizona for a report on the Rams and the Cardinals. But up front tonight, the baseball Cardinals finally know who they'll meet in the playoffs. Now, it used to be when the baseball season came down to the last day with a division title on the line, it meant something, like the Angels and Mariners last year. But today's game in Los Angeles was more significant to the Cardinals than it was to the teams playing. Because of the wild card, both the Padres and Dodgers were already in the playoffs. The winner of the game had to get on an airplane to come to St. Louis. The loser gets a day off, and they get to open the playoffs at home. This is baseball. Nobody said they thought this out. We go to Los Angeles. How seriously did Dodger manager Bill Russell take this game? He started Ramon Martinez, pitched him for one inning. Well, one guy who always wants to win should be MVP Ken Caminiti. The nice stop, and he starts the double play. Now, it was nothing-nothing in extra innings. Who would blink first? Two men on for Chris Gwynn in the 11th. Chan Ho Park on the mound. Gwynn hitting a mere 169, but he sends one to the gap in right center. Steve Finley is going to score. Ken Caminiti will also come around to score, and the Padres take a 2-0 lead. Now, the Padres can close it out. The Cardinals do not want to face this guy. His name is Trevor Hoffman. He freezes Chad Curtis, and the Padres complete the sweep. They win the West, and so they head east to St. Louis. Final was 2-0.
What about the Cardinals?
Well, we've got to work it out. Well, you know, after a little celebration here, we'll put this behind us and get ready for them.
We played well against them late. The last series we had, Wally got the big hit. So we know we can beat them, and we're just going to have to take it one pitch at a time like we have all year.
Well, not that the Cardinals were rooting for the Padres necessarily, but during the season, the Cards were 4-8 against the Dodgers and 8-4 against the Padres. You're looking at the Cards' playoff schedule opening up on Tuesday against the Padres at Busch Stadium at 3 o'clock, day off Wednesday, then they'll play again on Thursday, travel day on Friday, Saturday a 6:30 start St. Louis time, Cards and Padres at Jack Murphy Stadium. Sunday's game, it won't begin until 10 o'clock St. Louis time, then right back at it if necessary on Monday at 3 o'clock St. Louis time. So while the Cards will... playoff schedule is set. The Cards playoff roster is anything but. But in our Sports Plus spotlight tonight, we take a closer look at what could be a devastating loss to the Cardinals in the postseason. Center fielder Ray Lankford's availability is in serious question. Ray tore the rotator cuff in his left shoulder, making this diving catch on Friday night. He did not play in the last two games. And so far, the shoulder isn't responding to treatment. He's listed officially as day-to-day. The Cards won't make a decision on this playoff status until the last possible moment.
I don't have much range of motion right now, but like I said, Tuesday, who knows? We just got to take it one day at a time and see what happens.
I think the two calls really are, do you wait till, you know, do you wait? Does Tuesday tell you that he may be ready Saturday, in which case you might want to buy two games, or do you say no chance, you know, it'll be at least a week, then you can't, you got to do something else.
Now, Ray did make an appearance in the on-deck circle today, but only to thank the crowd for their support. Lenk said there was no way he was going to hit. He went out there in his running shoes, not his spikes. And this meeting between the Cards and Padres is somewhat ironic, don't you think? These past few days have been a celebration of Ozzie Smith's career, and he continues his final year against the team he played for in his first year. Ozzie and the Cards closed out the regular season today against the Reds. Let's roll it from Bush. Ozzie stepped into the batter's box in the first and received yet another standing ovation from the sellout crowd. The Cards jumped out on top in the second. John Mabry, the batter, he'll send one to the gap in right center. Gary Gaetti will hold up at third on the play, but the throw from the outfield is to nobody. And that allows Gaetti to score from third, part of a two-run inning. Redbirds up 2-0. And then right before the fourth, Ozzie Smith taken out of the game for yet another ovation and some hugs from his teammates. The Reds are playing for something to talk about until spring training. First, Barry Larkin homers. Then Willie Green follows up with a shot of his own, part of a three-run fourth inning. Reds were up 3-2. Cards would tie it up, but in the fifth, more irony. Ozzie Smith, you know, he's passed the best shortstop torch to Barry Larkin. Larkin hits his second home run of the game, a two-run shot. Reds up 5-3. They go on to win 6-3. But after the game, the Busch Stadium crowd would not leave until Ozzie, even in losing today, would take a victory lap. We'll have more on that later. Cards finish up the regular season with a record of 88-74. Their most victories since 1987, when they had 95, and that was the last time they were in the playoffs.
We want to take it a step or two further and be ready for Tuesday. I mean, we've overcome a lot of adversity this year, and we play better under pressure, so that's the reason why we feel so good.
To, you know, culminate it after all the special things that we've seen this year with, you know, a trip to the playoffs, I couldn't have written a better script or book about this type of season.
Stay with us. We won't drag you through endless, meaningless highlights. Only the best is coming up. We'll look back at 19 years of greatness as we pay tribute to the Wizard of Oz. We'll walk down the end of the road with Ozzie Smith. But up next, this was the day St. Louis football fans were supposed to get their revenge in the desert. Unfortunately, revenge was just a mirage. Stay tuned.
We thought that Phoenix offered the best opportunity to be competitive for the Cardinals.
That was the scene in 1988 as Bill Bidwell leaves St. Louis, taking his Cardinal football team with him to Phoenix. And on our rampage tonight, the game St. Louis fans have been waiting 8 years for, a chance at redemption, a chance at revenge. St. Louis football fans loved the Cardinals, but they never had the same warm feelings for their owner, Bill Bidwell. And today's game was more than just a chance for a win against a team with a losing record. It's the one we wanted bad. Chance to get back at Billy. What a disappointment. We roll it from Tempe, the first start ever for rookie quarterback Tony Banks. And Banks showed some early jitters. He fumbles this snap. The Cardinals recovered, but they were unable to capitalize on the turnover. The Rams special teams, though, gave them an early boost. Eddie Kennison fields the punt, breaks some tackles, and he's off to the races. They won't catch him today. 66 yards for the touchdown. It was 7-0 Rams. Second quarter, Banks, he's got some talent, and watch this pass. It's through double coverage to Isaac Farouse. The 54-yard touchdown, Rams up 14-0 after a fumble by the Big Red. Tony Banks not so lucky this time. He gets flushed out of the pocket, and he just floats one, picked off by Brent Alexander of the Cardinals. And this time, the Cards make them pay. Kent Graham to Rob Moore. Moore fights his way into the end zone, 24 yards on the score. Rams now lead 14-7. But Banks continues to show poise. Third down and two, rolls right, and he's got a man. The perfect touch to Eddie Kennison, 32 yards on the touchdown. Rams up 21-14 at the break, and you gotta love it. Second half, the Cardinals were being the Cardinals. They tried the fake punt by snapping the ball to LaShawn Johnson, but he had nowhere to go. Then Banks will go right to work. Hooks up with Isaac Farouse again, 43 yards. Then the nice move for the touchdown. Rams up 28-14. Fourth quarter, though, the Cardinals on the move. Rob Moore, he is leveled by Keith Lyle. However, The Cardinals were not intimidated. Larry Centers for the 6-yard touchdown. Cards now trail 28-21. Again, the Cardinals would get the ball late in the game. Fourth and long. On this play, the Rams are offsides. It's a free play, and they just quit. First down, Cardinals. And then the Cardinals in trouble again. Robert Jones busting through. But Graham, cool under pressure. DeFrank Sanders, the touchdown. His fourth of the game. 28 all. We head to overtime. In overtime, Cards get the ball first, and LaShawn Johnson, he rushed for 214 yards last week. He busts loose, breaks a tackle, and he's going to go 65 of his 97 yards on the day, all the way down inside the Rams' 10-yard line. And that set up this. Greg Davis from 25 yards out, and the Cardinals win. Final was 31-28. The numbers point to what could have been a huge win for the Rams. Tony Banks lit a fire into the offense with the first three touchdown passes of the season. Isaac Bruce topped the century mark in yardage, but Graham unstoppable. 58 attempts, 366 yards, and the Cardinals offense kept the Rams defense on the field for over 41 minutes.
Yeah, they get their touchdown to tie it, and the worst possible thing that could have happened is that they win the toss and we have to put our tired defense back out on the field.
There's some positive things you can look back.
Yeah, I guess you could look at it that way. You know, in the locker room after a loss, I can't really think of too many things positive to build on. It's a loss.
And once again, the Rams were undisciplined. Eight penalties, including one on the final play of the game, as well as one on fourth down, gave the Cardinals a key first down on the touchdown tying drive. Well, not only did we want this one for revenge, not only was it a matter of civic pride, but the Rams needed this game. Their record falls to a dismal 1-3. And for more, we take you by satellite to Phoenix and our Frank Cusimano. Good evening, Frank.
Well, good evening, Mike. And this one was certainly painful. You know, last year this time, the Rams were riding the crest of a 4-game winning streak, and they were the talk of the NFL. Today, they lose to a franchise which some consider the worst in the National Football League. Now, there were plenty of positives. Tony Banks was out of sight, and Eddie Kennison continues to be a star in the making. But today, they asked their defense to play a large chunk of a 3.5-hour game in 97-degree heat, and the defense could not answer the bell in the 15th round. Normally, the NFL is about skill level. The teams with more of it usually win. But today was about fatigue. In the end, the Rams' defense was gasping for air, but could not catch their breath.
It was hell out there.
Yeah, it's near death.
We reached the point of exhaustion, yeah. Our defense was, we were pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing. It just seemed like there was just no end to it.
It's a catch-22 situation for the Rams. I mean, you want to make big plays, but sometimes when you do, your drives only last 10 seconds. Like this 49-yard strike from Tony Banks to Isaac Bruce. But later in the third quarter, the Cardinals began a 19-play, 93-yard drive, which lasted 10 minutes and 22 seconds. The Rams' D was breathing hard.
And you want to get there and you want to, you know, give it all you got, but sometimes you don't have that much to give.
Next, a 12-play, 62-yard drive, which finished with a game-tying touchdown with 11 seconds left.
It's a test of manhood out there, and we came up short today.
And finally, the LaShawn Johnson run, which simply broke this team's back. However, as the coach points out, the defense did have their opportunities.
All we needed was one or two plays, just somebody to make a play and stop the drive, and we're going to win the football game. But they made the plays, and we didn't, and you got to give them credit for making the plays.
So Rich Brooks was a dejected man after this game, and I imagine a lot of St. Louisans feel the same way. Anybody who lived and died with the Big Red in the 60s and 70s and 80s at Busch Stadium really wanted this football game badly. It just seems strange to say the Arizona Cardinals against the St. Louis Rams. Everybody was ornery. Rams fans in Arizona who didn't want them to leave L.A.
What do you think about Georgia Frontier? And
I don't like her. She needs to bring the Rams back to L.A.
And St. Louis fans who still have it in for Bill Bidwell.
I'd like to see Bill Bidwell's team lose after moving away from St. Louis just for the money to come down here. We'd like nothing better than the Rams to crush him today.
It was a bit odd. Number 81 in a Cardinal uniform should be Jackie Smith, right? And 15 is Neil Lomax, isn't it? 83, Pat Tilley. And 85, oh, that's Mel Gray. Who are these guys? St. Louisans rooting against the Cardinals. Well, to tell you the truth, there wasn't much rooting going on at all. 40,000 empty seats and just 33,000 in the house.
A lot of apathy. We wonder why they haven't won, and
they are really going to care until they win, and it's as simple as that. You know, they want winning. If they're not going to win, they're not going to come out.
Even the owner wasn't real fired up. What does it mean to Bill Bidwell, honestly?
Well, we've been away now. This is our ninth season in Arizona. I don't have any emotion on the game. It's just a football game that literally both teams have to win. So it's going to be decided on the field.
The players knew it was a spicy rivalry, but for most of them, it was just another game.
We as a team, we wasn't really trying to be worried about it too much. We just need to go out and win.
It's important to St. Louis because of the obvious reasons, but I think it was more important for the guys in this room. We needed to get to 2-2.
And Mike, about an hour after the game, we were picking up our equipment and Bill Bidwell was driving by in a golf cart, and I went up to him and I said, congratulations. He simply said, thank you, and he drove off. He is a different kind of guy, and if he had any emotion, he certainly didn't show it to us on camera or after the game. That's the story from Arizona. I'm Frank Cusumano reporting. Malcolm, Mike, back to you.
Well, Frank, you know, moving the team was one thing, but then promising to help St. Louis and then voting against an expansion franchise and the Rams move, well, revenge would have been so sweet. All right, Frank, thanks very much, and Sports Plus continues right after this. And Sports Plus rolls on, and on this final day of the baseball regular season, we roll the highlight reel, and we start in Baltimore, where Davey Johnson and the Orioles looking to tune up for the playoffs against the Jays. First inning, Brady Anderson going deep to right, a leadoff homer, the 12th time he had done that. That sets a new major league record. It's also his 50th homer of the season. It would be the only run the O's would get as Pat Henkin shut them down, and he gets his 20th win. Toronto wins. Final was 4-1. Next to Fenway, was this Roger Clemens' final appearance there? Yankees and Red Sox game tied at 3 in the ninth when Reggie Jefferson gets the base hit. Red Sox knock off the Yankees. Final of the day was 6-5. The Yankees had the Texas Rangers next. The Rangers, though, didn't lose today thanks to midseason pickup Kevin Elster's two-run homer as the Rangers win. Final was 4-3, and that's the end of the reel. All right, let's check the final board. The Braves getting ready to play the Dodgers. They lose to Montreal. It was Philadelphia over New York. Chicago fired pitching coach Fergie Jenkins. They lose today. Houston, on the final day of the season, they finally win one. Colorado, they beat San Francisco 12-3. Now, in the American League, Boston over New York. The Yankees will meet the Rangers in the first round of the playoffs. Henkin with his 20th win. We showed you that. Toronto 4-1 over Baltimore. Milwaukee beats Detroit as Alan Trammell announces his retirement. It was Minnesota 5, Chicago 4. Cleveland losing to Kansas City 4-1. The Indians finish with 99 wins. Texas 4-3 over California. And it was Oakland 3, Seattle 1. So here's how the playoffs will stack up. In the National League, of course, the Cardinals and the Padres. The other matchup has the Dodgers going up against the Braves. That series gets underway on Wednesday. In the American League, the Texas Rangers make their first ever postseason appearance. They'll take on Joe Torre's Yankees. And Baltimore's back in the playoffs for the first time since 1983. They'll play the Central Division champion Indians. Both of those series will begin on Tuesday. All right, back to football. There were still four NFL teams with squeaky clean undefeated records when this day started. But when it ended, well, let's begin in New York for the upset of the day. Giants head coach Dan Reeves is on the hot seat, but it's a little cooler tonight against the undefeated Vikings. G-men run the end around, and Aaron Pierce gonna take it in. It gives the Giants a 12-7 lead. Can they hold on? Yes, thanks to three field goals by Brad Deluiso. The Giants and the Vikings, their first loss of the season. Final was 15-10. Carolina was undefeated, an expansion team with a catitude. But that other expansion team can play too. Jacksonville's Mark Brunell for Jimmy Smith. The 8-yard touchdown, the Jags roll. Final was 24-14. To San Diego, Junior Seau and the Chargers looking to hand the Chiefs their first loss. Chiefs quarterback Steve Bono, he passed for 280 yards and two touchdowns, including this one to Reggie Johnson to tie the game at 16. With the game tied at 19, John Kearney from 33 yards out gives San Diego the lead. Now, just 28 seconds left. Pete Stojanovic will try to tie the game for the Chiefs, but his kick is blocked by Chris Mims, and the Chargers win 22-19. Jeff Fisher and the Oilers in Pittsburgh against the Steelers. Jerome Bettis, the former Ram, takes a hit. Boom, nailed by Joe Bowden. But this was all Steelers. Mike Tomczak and that other quarterback, Cordell Stewart, watched the pretty play. For the touchdown, Steelers beat the Oilers final 30-16. Into San Francisco, Steve Young with the day off due to a groin injury, but the defense stepped it up. Former Ram Marquez Pope picks off the Bobby Hebert pass, and they won't catch him today. 55 yards for the touchdown. Niners win easily the final 39-17. Your mission bells were up by ancient men. And here come all the NFL scores in the new AP College Football Poll on an Elton John roll. Brick Road must come to an end, and this weekend, the Wizard of Oz said goodbye. Welcome back to Sports Plus. The end of the road has a nice little detour for Ozzie Smith, right into the National League playoffs. But while the Cardinals hope to celebrate a world championship in a few weeks, this weekend was the time to celebrate Ozzie's career. And for the next 30 minutes, that's exactly what we're going to do. After all, we're talking about the greatest shortstop of all time, and this incredible Hall of Fame ride began almost two decades ago.
From the St. Louis Cardinals, shortstop Ozzie Smith.
It's hard to imagine him as anything but a St. Louis Cardinal, but Ozzie first began to cast the spells of a wizard as a San Diego Padre after only 68 games in the minor leagues. During his 4 years in San Diego, Ozzie won his first two Gold Gloves and pulled off what he still considers to be his favorite defensive play. Atlanta's Jeff Burrows hit a shot up the middle. It caromed off a rock. The wizard stabbed the ball with his bare hand, got to his feet, and threw Burrows out at first. But things soured for Ozzie in San Diego. A salary dispute led to a controversial trade to the Cardinals for fellow shortstop Gary Templeton in February of 1982.
What I would like people to do is appreciate me for Ozzie Smith, and Gary Templeton is his own person. I've had a lot of time in the last couple of months to sit down and really analyze where I was headed, and I feel at this time that this is probably the best thing that's happened to me, and hopefully it'll do a lot for my career.
It didn't take long for Ozzie to make an impact. On April 13th, he homered in leading the Cards to a win over the Cubs. It was his first homer in 4 years, and that was just the beginning of what would be a special season. Cards won the Eastern Division title and went on to sweep Atlanta for the National League pennant. Cards were in the World Series for the first time in 14 years. Against the Milwaukee Brewers, Ozzie performed his magic on a national stage. He went on to set a record for the most putouts by a shortstop in a 7-game World Series. And the Cardinals scaled to the top of baseball's mountain.
Suter from the belt to the plate. A swing and a miss, and that's a winner! That's a winner! A World Series winner for the Cardinals!
The Cards would win two more pennants in the 1980s, while Ozzie went about putting himself among baseball's elite.
Leading off from the St. Louis Cardinals, shortstop Ozzie Smith.
Voted to the National League lineup in 10 consecutive All-Star games.
Here's a fly ball into center field. Hatcher backing up.
He messed it up.
And it's off the wall. And two runs will score. And it's a double for Ozzie.
Runner-up for the National League Most Valuable Player Award in 1987, a season in which he set career highs in runs, hits, doubles, and RBIs, in addition to hitting .303. And, of course, there was defense.
2-2. Fastball, and he hit it.
A great stop by Ozzie. Got him. Oh, what a player. Yes, sir, you are worth $1 million.
You're unbelievable.
Unbelievable. And the throw. He got him.
Outstanding play.
And for a guy who's been a star in TV.
Are they rolling or not?
Yeah, wait.
Yes, I'm rolling.
And in the movies, he's possessed a Hollywood flair for the dramatic.
Here is the pitch. Swing and a pop fly behind short. Coming hard is Ford, and they dive. Ozzie caught it. It was fantastic.
Smith corks one into right down the line. It may go. Go crazy, folks. Go crazy. It's a home run, and the Cardinals have won the game by the score of 3-2 and a home run by the Wizard.
It was an emotional moment in 1992 as Ozzie reached a cherished offensive milestone.
Ozzie Smith with hit number 2,000, and he stands at third with a triple. History right here for Ozzie Smith.
The ovation from the fans brought tears to his eyes, and it was a similar reaction on June 19th this year when Ozzie announced this season would be his last.
As I complete my final season as an active player, I would like nothing better for all of us than to be a part of one more world championship team. I just want to thank everyone who has helped the Cardinals and me during the last 15 years. Thank you.
Three weeks later, Ozzie made his final All-Star game appearance, and the Philadelphia fans, not known for showering praise, gave the Wizard an emotional farewell. And as the season continued, so did the tributes in every National League city along the way. And perhaps Ozzie summed it up best one night in Colorado. Baseball fans and Ozzie Smith, well, it's a mutual admiration society.
It's been a fun ride. Thank you for sharing my dream. Thank you.
Spent any time around Ozzie over the last couple of months, more than anything else, you've heard him talk about two things: his teammates and, of course, his family. Let's begin with the former. Our Trey Wingo has spent some time talking with Ozzie's teammates over the last several weeks, and Trey joins us now with more. Trey?
Well, Mike, during his great Cardinal career, Ozzie Smith played with 27 different second basemen alone, from the great Tommy Herr to the infamous Ramon Caraballo, and you can bet Ozzie touched every one of them. But his golden glove wasn't just limited to double play partners. You know, the old saying goes, you're only as good as your teammates, which means all the Cardinals who lined up with the Wizard got much more than they bargained for.
What makes the perfect teammate? Is it great defense? If so, then Ozzie Smith is the guy you want to line up with. The numbers don't lie. He has all those gold gloves and all-star game appearances for a reason or two.
Even in practice and stuff like that, he's always like throwing around without looking, and then he's just pretty accurate when he does things like that.
It's a great comfort feeling that, you know, that anything hit on the ground, you know, to the left side of the infield, the guy's going to be out.
Is the perfect teammate a clutch hitter? Then Ozzie Smith is your guy. Over 2,400 hits in 19 seasons. Not bad when you consider when he came up, he was all glove, no stick.
Right here for Ozzie Smith.
Ozzie hits from both sides of the plate, which helps him. And he's more experienced.
Works hard every day and does the same routine, you know, whether he's feeling good or bad or, you know, indifferent. He goes out there and does what he needs to do to get prepared.
Does the perfect teammate show character coming through when it matters most? Then Ozzie Smith is the guy. Case in point, Labor Day 96 against the Astros. It was the Wizard who led the Birds back from a four-run deficit. And with the division title in sight late in September, it was Ozzie Smith who got the offense going in a come-from-behind win against the Cubs.
He knows how to play the game, and he knows how to make things happen. And, you know, he was 41, 42 years old, and he could still ignite offense.
But perhaps nothing epitomized Ozzie Smith, the teammate, more than what happened going into his 19th and final Major League season. For the first time since he was called up in San Diego, Ozzie found himself fighting for a starting job.
Royce Clayton was the inherited shortstop of the future, but Ozzie Smith was still the incumbent. It could have been ugly. Instead, Ozzie simply made it work.
My childhood hero, so.
That was me before.
Yeah, when I was a little kid, so. You know, like I said, it hasn't been a negative situation, and it makes it that much sweeter when this team is winning and have a chance to win the pennant, so that's all that matters right now.
A really special credit goes to Ozzie and Royce. You put yourself in their shoes, which I tried to a few times, and, you know, there are days where the other definitely deserved to play. They both should have played more than they played, but they somehow put it aside, and when it was their turn, they played as hard as they could, and they've been very effective.
So what then is the perfect teammate? Perhaps the best definition of the term simply goes by the name Osborne Earl Smith.
And Mike, since he's one of the few players to actually play with both Barry Larkin and Ozzie Smith, I asked Ron Gant to compare the two shortstops, and Ron summed it up this way. Barry may go to the Hall of Fame someday, but I know Ozzie's going. Mike?
And Trey, you mentioned it, 27 second basemen since he's been a Cardinal.
Right.
And he still holds the record for double plays by a shortstop. All right, Trey, thank you very much. Now, whatever Ozzie Smith has achieved in the game of baseball, his best effort was always put in away from the ballpark. He will be the first to tell you that his game is his passion, but that's not the real love of his life. And with more on this, we're joined now by our Malcolm Briggs. Malcolm?
Mike, for almost two decades, the Wizard has honed and polished his craft. It was almost second nature. But being a father is a job no one can prepare you for. You can't go shag balls and become better at it. His Hall of Fame career doesn't even come close to the job he's done raising the Smith kids three.
They are the ultimate gifts in what has been truly a blessed life. The Smith kids three. Meet the other Osborne Earl Smith, a.k.a. O.J. This is how O.J. gets his kicks. Karate is one of his chosen sports. For his entire life, his father has been shared with the baseball-loving world.
Sometimes I did, but when I was younger, I got jealous. But now I understand that that's his job.
Over the years, millions have come to watch Ozzie Smith do his thing at Busch Stadium. As the eldest son of arguably the greatest shortstop of all time, you would figure that baseball would be in O.J.'s future. Well, such is not the case.
Man, I got mad at one point because everybody was coming up to me. Oh, are you going to be just like your dad?
Yeah.
And you're probably going to have 13 gold gloves just like your dad.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah, I'm not going to play baseball. Probably not.
This may be a future two-sport star for the Smiths, 9-year-old Dustin. Like his father, Dustin is a big hoops fan. His father was an all-city selection back in his day.
I'm just following like my dad. He used to play basketball, and he was a good player, and I just want to follow his footsteps.
Following in his footsteps means playing baseball. With Dustin, that's a given. For both of these guys, come Sunday, their baseball dad becomes just dad. That will be something new for the Smith boys.
Is it going to make you sad that he's not playing anymore?
Well, no. Well, sort of, yeah, because I always remember that he's a great dad and he's a great baseball player.
It's probably going to be more fun. We're going to have more time to spend together. And he's probably going to help me with more things.
Six-year-old Taryn, the princess in Ozzie's life.
It can be this one or this one.
Her doll collection occupies most of her day, but she's preparing for that last day for her dad. She's got something special in store for him.
You gonna bake him any cookies or anything?
Yeah.
No, you're not.
Mm-hmm.
What kind?
His favorite.
Which are?
Oreos.
Ozzie Smith will undoubtedly leave a mark on the world. Many will say it's baseball, but a picture tells the real story.
Ozzie's kids look forward to hanging out with their old man. Hopefully it will be after October, and who knows, they could be playing with a 1996 world champion. Mike?
Now, wouldn't that be the icing on the cake?
Oh, that'd be sweet.
All right, Malcolm, thank you very much. You know, when Ozzie was just a kid, he excelled not just at baseball, but at several sports. He certainly wasn't the biggest athlete at Locke High School in Los Angeles. In fact, he wasn't even the best on his baseball team. His teammate was another future Hall of Famer, Eddie Murray. But it wasn't hard to see that Ozzie was special.
He seemed to have known the direction that he wanted to go. You know. Very, very good work ethics. And, from judging by that, you could tell the guy would, you know, succeed at something.
We've heard from his teammates, we've heard from his family, and now it's time to hear from the Wizard himself. I sat down with Oz for about an hour recently, and we talked about his life and his career, and I began the conversation by asking about these past couple of months as he heads toward a retirement and what it's been like.
Though it's a sad time, it's also a joyous time, you know, because I've enjoyed something here in my life that not many people get to enjoy. You know, I've enjoyed 19 years of doing what I truly love doing. And I think that what's transpiring now is that people are giving me the love that I tried to show for this game. They're giving it back to me. And it's a wonderful feeling. Not many guys get to experience what Ozzie Smith is experiencing now, going around baseball and having people show their love and their admiration and their appreciation for what he tried to bring to the sport. Well, I remember having to sleep on the floor because of all of the sniper fire. I lived across the street from Manchester Recreation Center, where the National Guard actually set up tents and stuff. So it was a pretty disturbing time in my life. But, you know, everybody, I think, when we talk about South Central Los Angeles, the Watch, you know, everybody want to play on the fact that, well, you know, we come from such bad backgrounds. I think that's unimportant. The important thing was that you were able to take advantage of a situation when it presented itself. You were able to better yourself. You were able to get out. And that's what it was all about. It was about making your surroundings a little bit better than they were when you grew up. And I've been able to do that.
But what was instilled in you to make that happen? Because there are kids who probably live to the left of you, to the right of you, who didn't do that, who got into trouble.
Well, I think that it has a lot to do with the way that you're reared, your family background. My mom, has probably been the backbone of our family. making sure that, you know, education was first, getting a good education. And we had chores, we had responsibilities, and we had to get those things done if we wanted to do the extra things, if we wanted to play sports.
I bet you I bought over $100 worth of light bulbs. He lay in the bed playing ball and throwing it up. In the bed, laying in the bed with his glove on, throwing that ball. He tore up the man's garage on the outside playing wall ball with that ball on the outside. When he come in the house, he swung the bat. I'm telling you, he had to play ball. He just had to play.
Let's get ready to rumble!
I played on a team that had Eddie Murray. You know, so when people came out, you know, they came out, when scouts came out, they came out to see Eddie hit the ball over the fence, you know, as he did quite often in high school. But, you know, I felt that my skills were pretty good at the time. When I signed with the Padres, I said to myself that if I hadn't made it to the big leagues in 5 years, then, you know, I was going to go ahead and get my teaching credential and say that, hey, I had the chance. You know, and that would be the end of it. I wouldn't be a minor league player all my career. And so I got drafted in 1977. I went to Walla Walla, Washington, where I played 78 ball games. I got invited to Instructional League by Alvin Dark. I played in Instructional League for a couple of weeks. In 1978, I got invited to big league camp.
1 year in the minor leagues, and you're getting in the big league camp, and you make the team.
You know, I made the team. But I also had a scare because Alvin Dark, the guy who had brought me to the big leagues, got fired in spring training. So that was a little scary. But at the time that he got fired, he came to me and he said, hey, these things happen in baseball. He said, but you continue to do what you do and you'll be a great one. The organization felt at the time that I probably wasn't going to get any better offensively. I was good defensively, but, you know, they saw the chance of getting a great offensive player in Gary Templeton, which he was. So, you know, there was a lot of criticism about the fact that I was being traded for a player who had gotten 100 hits from both sides of the plate. I myself didn't put any added pressure on myself by saying that I have to go out and be this great offensive player. I knew that with my skills and my ability to put the ball or keep the ball in play, that with a little work and my work ethic, then there'd be no reason for me not to become a good offensive player.
Bring it on!
Before the ball is hit, are you thinking, I want it, hit it to me? What are you thinking?
Well, I think that, you know, that's first. You have to want the ball hit to you. The minute you say, oh, boy, I hope this ball is not hit to me, it's going to be hit to you. So it's one of those things, and there's a term in baseball, you know, a rug rat, you know, a guy that has a nose for the ball, you know, always being around the ball. And I've always took on the challenge of attacking the baseball, never letting the baseball attack you, but attacking the baseball and trailing the baseball all over the field. And I think that was one of the reasons that Whitey Herzog wanted me here, because I was one of those rug rats that would chase the baseball all over the field until I caught it. So, you know, when I'm out there, it's about having that thing hit to me, because It's that type of attitude that I think that allow you to do things that that go beyond what you feel you're capable of doing.
The 1980s, three National League pennants, one World Championship. Is that the chunk of time you'll remember as the most special?
Sure, the 80s were a very special time, and I think that at the time that you're going through it, you don't really have a chance to appreciate it as much as you do now reminiscing about it. You know, each of the teams that we're playing on, and you try and compare the team now to those teams then, and you say, boy, oh, how special we were. The realization of how special we really was. And the thing that we try and convey to young players now is to to try and have a little bit more appreciation for it than we did, because we were working so hard at what we did at getting to this point, to that point, and stuff that we just kind of got consumed with it and really didn't appreciate it. But now as we look back on it, it allows us to appreciate it even more, because those are special times. When I went to the ballpark that day, I had no idea that something like that would happen. We knew that something magical had to happen if we were going to give ourselves a chance at winning the pennant. And sure enough, you know, you hope that you're the guy that is able to do whatever it takes to get your team over that hurdle. And it just so happened that that was my moment in time. I hear that every day of my life, you know, don't retire, you know, play another 2 years, play another 3 years, you know, play another year. At this particular time, my decision to retire remains the same. I said something a couple weeks ago that here again people took, and they ran with it because I'm playing so well. I said that as a human being and as an American, I reserve the right to change my mind if I choose to do that.
Unfortunately, Busch Stadium only holds about 50,000 people, so there were a lot of St. Louis fans who couldn't be there for the farewell to Oz Day. Is there anything you'd like to say to those St. Louis fans?
You know, Mike, I've thought about this a zillion times, and, you know, it's very hard to put into words exactly what it is that you feel for the support that people have given you through the years. And, you know, we've all enjoyed some blood, some sweat, some tears, happy moments, some sad moments, some joyous moments. But the bottom line is just being able to say thank you to the people that have been a part of this storybook career of mine. You know, just thank you for sharing it, and hopefully, what I did on the baseball field brightened your life or touched your life in a positive way.
Welcome back to Sports Plus and our tribute to Ozzie. It was a Cardinal weekend of meaningless games, but meaningful accolades. This was Ozzie's weekend. And yesterday at Busch Stadium, as Frank Cusimano reports, it was Ozzie's day.
There weren't many empty seats or dry eyes in the house. Every word Ozzie Smith delivered, he had to fight back the tears.
I've often been asked, what was my greatest highlights? But I must say, for being here today, with my family and 50,000 of my closest friends, has to be one of them.
His mom put it best.
He has so many friends.
And over 20 of those friends spoke on his behalf. St. Louis legends Stan Musial and Bob Costas, Whitey Herzog and Willie McGee. Presents? Well, how many players get two cars on retirement day? A Mercedes from the owners, and a Camaro from his friend Johnny Landolf. But he wasn't just a player. Ozzie Smith was an entertainer.
Ozzie Smith had that quality that captured something special about the game. When he went into the hole to pick up a ground ball and bounce back up to throw across the diamond, we were reminded every time why we love this game.
And he finished his speech like he's finishing his career, graceful and stylish.
Thank each and every one of you for traveling down my yellow brick road. Thank you.
For Sports Plus, Frank Cusimano, News Channel 5 Sports.
And just one final thought. We don't have many sports heroes anymore, athletes that not only want to be, but are proud to be role models. That's why we'll miss Ozzie Smith. He wore number one on his uniform, and he's number one in our hearts. When the game ended today, Ozzie's last regular season game, nearly everybody at Busch Stadium stuck around to watch him take a grand tour, to shake hands, and
and to say goodbye one more time. We leave you tonight with those images, and we look forward to more Ozzie and more Cardinals baseball in the playoffs. And that's Sports Plus for tonight. Thanks for keeping us company. I'm Mike Bush. Hope to see you tomorrow night at 5, 6, and 10. And from all of us at Sports Plus, good night, everybody.
I can't say thank you enough to everybody that has been a part of my dream. St. Louis is the greatest place on the face of the earth. Thank you.